Hey TSM, it's Mark here. We're on YouTube now. Hopefully you were able to find us. If not, maybe you found us later on because somebody who is watching right now shared this with you. So whether you're watching this on YouTube as it premieres or you're watching it later, we're so glad that you're able to join us. Feel free to comment, and our leaders and will be commenting and replying to those comments as we see them come through. But we're so glad you're able to join us. Of course, we wish we could be actually in our youth room together in person. Unfortunately, right now we can't do that, but please know that we're praying for you. We love you guys. We can't wait to gather in person again soon, but we want to continue to connect with you, whether that's ways like this on YouTube or our Zoom game nights or whatever it might be. We want to just continue to connect with you. So feel free to reach out, send me a message or an email or Aaron or your leaders. We are here for you guys. We love you guys so much. But before I continue on, we have Aaron who is going to share some announcements with you guys. So I look forward to hearing those. So I'm going to turn it over to Aaron now.
Hey guys, welcome to TSM. We're so excited you're here with us. And I have been praying for you this entire week for your first week of online school. And we hope it's going great for you. Hopefully you've gotten outside to get in some vitamin D. It's been nice weather, and that's been a blessing for sure. So if there's anything else that we can be praying for you, please let us know. Otherwise, we're still checking up on you guys and seeing how you're doing. And I have a few announcements for you. This week, Monday night, we have a Devo that will be playing live. So you can either catch it live or you can watch it at your own leisure on Facebook or on Instagram. We encourage you to check that out. And we also have our Thursday night game nights, which is 7 p.m. every Thursday this entire month of April. So check it out. We have our Zoom number, which will be in every weekly email, and your parents can find it there. Otherwise, you can find it on our Instagram and our Facebook page to dial in. If you're having trouble, please text me or Mark and we can get that to you right away. So we also want to let you know about Easter. So this next Sunday is Easter Sunday, and we encourage you guys to be with your families for the Easter morning gathering at 10 a.m., which is live online. And we will not be having TSM in the evening. We want you to just hang out with your family and have some fun. So we are praying for your week. We love you. And it's back to you, Mark.
I'm really excited that we're going to have Miranda as well lead us in some worship songs here in a few minutes. But before we do that, you know, I have to share some memes because, like I said, you're either going to laugh or cry right now in the midst of a global pandemic. So here are some memes. There's just so many memes right now. It's really hard to keep up. So feel free to send those to me, email or direct message us. We'll filter through those and filter through the youth group appropriate memes. So we're going to put some of these up on the screen for you guys. But the first one I want to share with you is this one. Here it comes. Can we uninstall 2020 and reinstall it? I believe it has a virus. I love the play on words there. Definitely 2020 has a virus. We wish we could uninstall that one for sure. How about this one? This one you probably have seen. Here's Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he has this hand that you can see there, and it says, "Me after washing my hands for 20 seconds 126 times in one day." I guess you become a Terminator. I guess that's a handy thing to turn into in terms of a crisis or a pandemic. Here's another one. Everybody, 2020 is finally going to be our year 3 months later. Maybe you guys have seen that episode of The Office where just people are going crazy. I believe maybe there's like a Dwight's pretending to do have a fire drill or whatever, and maybe there's a real fire. Here's another one, an Office one. People who say coronavirus, people who say COVID-19. I think that's pretty funny. So there's another one too. I need to pull this one up. This will be my last one for the evening. See if I can find it. Looks like I found it. Here we go.
Don't you say that. Don't you ever say that. Stay here. Stay as long as you can. For the love of God, cherish it.
Jennifer, why don't you try reading out loud for a minute, okay?
You gotta cherish it. You do.
So please send me your memes. Mark's memes is kind of a segment that will be reoccurring as long as there's a pandemic. So there's that, I guess, to look forward to right now. But thank you guys for humoring me with the memes. Now we're going to turn things over. It's hard to transition from these memes to worship songs, but we'll do the best we can. So thank you, Miranda, for leading us. We really appreciate it. And I'll turn it over to her.
Hey, everybody. It's Miranda here. Just getting worship kind of set up for you guys. It's an early morning for me, so I haven't had my coffee yet, but I'm super happy to be here and just to get to worship with you and lead worship through video. And I just hope that it reaches you wherever you're at and that you can just sit for the next 10 minutes or 5 minutes or however long it is and just feel the presence of the Lord through this video and also through what Mark has to say and things like that. We miss you guys a lot, and it sucks that we can't be together all in one place, but again, like I said last week, amazing that the Lord has blessed us with technology like this to be able to record and do stuff via phones. Andrew and I have had a lot of change in our life recently. Getting married, losing one of my best friends the week of our wedding, and then we moved, and in the midst of moving, Andrew lost his grandma, and just a lot of changes and a lot of uncertainty and a lot of just unknown. And as we've been going through all of that, there's just been a lot on my mind and a lot of things that I've been just working through. And there's a song by Tori Kelly called Psalms 42, and one of the first verses that she obviously pulls it from Psalm 42, but one of the first things that sticks out to me is the chorus, which it kind of goes, as a deer pants for the water, so my soul needs you, Lord. And every time I listen to that song, it just puts me in this place of how much we need the Lord and how much I need the Lord and how much my soul and how me as a person in my life just needs him there all the time. If you ever get a chance to listen to that song, go ahead. It's a beautiful song. But it just reminds me that even during these times where we're stuck in the house and stuck, you know, just being here, it's a good song that just reminds me how much I need the Lord still and how much he can help me through the things that I may be going through. So if you ever get a chance to listen to it, I highly recommend it. And she also has another song called Questions that's also really good that has helped me through a lot of things as well. So if you're going through something, take a listen to those songs. But we're going to get into worship. Sorry, I ramble. I've got three songs this morning. Most of you guys know them. If you don't, just feel free to just listen and take some time. I'm going to pray and then start singing. So, Lord, I just thank you for this day and just thank you for a time of worship where we just get to feel your presence and just hear the words that you're trying to speak to us, God. I ask that as we go through our day, if we have already, but tomorrow, whatever it may be, God, I ask that we just feel you and see you and know, Lord, that we long to be with you and our soul just desires you. And I just ask that you be with us as we go through our week and help us to just feel your presence, even if we're at home all day. So, amen. Okay. The first song that I'm going to sing is We're going to do this one. So it's an older hymn. Not really an older hymn, but most of you know it. It's How Deep the Father's Love. So you know the words, great. I can give you some time to look up the lyrics if you want. I really, really love the song because it really just portrays the love that Christ has for us and how to truly, I mean, not to use the song title, but really how deep his love is for us. And it's just a perfect picture of the love that Christ has. So, all right. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. The next one I'm going to sing is What a Beautiful Name. A lot of the students, you guys know this. So not only are we singing about this amazing love that God has, but also what an amazing God that we get to serve and that we get to love in return and share that love with everyone else around us. I think this song really just depicts, again, just the amazing power and the amazing love that Christ has for us and just the truth that we can hold on to when we're having trouble or sorrow or whatever it may be. Something that, a song that we can listen to and just remember the power of Christ and the power of the God that we get to serve. So sing with me if you know it. You are the Word at the beginning, one with God the now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. And death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring at the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. For yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
The last song I'm going to sing is Beneath the Waters, I Will Rise. I also really, I love a lot of worship songs, but I really think this song has been just speaking to me this week. Just remembering and knowing, you know, what Christ did for us on the cross and what he did for me on the cross, and realizing that because of what he did, we have new life in Christ, and that we will rise above all of the things that we go through, and that he's always there, and that he's always going to be there for us. And yeah, I don't know, just the words in this song just spoke to me that, you know, despite what I'm going through, Christ died on the cross for my sin, and because of that, I am a new creation, and I am a new person, and I can stand against the enemy in faith and in confidence, knowing that Christ is there, and knowing that someday I will get to celebrate with him in heaven. And just realizing that and knowing that no power or anything can bring me down, because that is because of what Christ did for us on the cross. So if you know the words, sing with me. Otherwise, feel free to just listen and pray and do what you gotta do. I apologize. I'm just getting over a sickness. So my throat, my voice is a little hoarse, but we'll get through it. And this is my revelation, Christ Jesus crucified. And salvation through repentance at the cross on which he died. And now hear my absolution, forgiveness for my sin. And I sink beneath the waters that Christ was buried in. And I will rise, I will rise, as Christ was raised to life. Now in him, I live. And I stand a new creation, baptized in blood and fire. No fear of condemnation, by faith I'm justified. And I will rise, I will rise, as Christ was raised to life. Now in him, I live. And I will rise, I will rise, as Christ was raised to life. And now in Now in him I live. And I rise as you are risen, declare your rule and reign. My life confess your lordship and glorify your name. Your word, it stands eternal. Your kingdom knows no end. Your praise goes on forever and on again. No power can stand against you. No, sorry. No power can stand against you. No curse assault your throne. No one can steal your glory, for it is yours alone. I stand to see your praises. I stand to testify, for I was dead in my sin. But now I rise, I will rise. This Christ Now in him. I will rise. I will rise. As Christ was raised to life, and now in Him, I live. Hope you guys have a great rest of your week. I miss seeing you. I hope that these words have spoken to you and that you just feel more love today. Bye.
Thank you, Miranda, for leading us in worship. It's such a blessing to be able to worship the Lord and just prepare our hearts for what He has for us. And maybe even speaking to us during those times. In fact, not maybe, definitely speaking to us as we are worshiping Him, setting our eyes on Him. Now, we're going to continue to look at the Gospel of Mark, Mark's account of the life of Jesus, specifically the events leading up to His death, and then also His resurrection. Last week, if you missed it, you can go on Facebook and see what we were talking about with Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane and everything that went down there. Jesus really in anguish. He was just in dread, really. This is the most difficult thing He's ever had to go through. Really, anybody probably in human history has gone through. He asks His Father, Father, if it's possible to take this cup. But not my will, but Your will be done. And we can see the disciples, not just somebody who can't pick Jesus out from a lineup. These three men who are His closest followers, His most trusted followers, they're falling asleep on Him. He was talking about how the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. How part of them is ready for anything in God, and the other part of them is like a lazy old dog just falling asleep by the fire, as the message so greatly puts. And we too, during the season, we can feel like that, right? We can feel like, yeah, I'm ready for anything in God, but I just want to sleep this global pandemic away. I just want to wake up and have it be a nightmare, or wake up and I hear on the news that it's over. And we can really wrestle with this. I know I have. But tonight we're going to continue to look at the life of Jesus, the events leading to His death. And Mark, I asked Selah and Carter to read from this passage that we're going to be looking at. So thank you guys so much for doing that. Once they're done reading, then we'll come back here and I'll share some thoughts from God's word with you.
And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And on the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of my bystanders hearing it said, behold, he is calling Elijah. And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down. And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple is torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, truly this man was the Son of God. There were also women looking on from a distance, among whom were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, the younger and of Joseph and Salome. When he was in Galilee, they followed him and ministered to him. And there was also many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. Thank you very much.
Hi, this is Selah, and I'll be reading from Mark chapter 15, verse 42 through 16, verse 8. And when evening had come, since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself looking for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised to hear that he should have already died, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the corpse to Joseph. And Joseph bought a linen shroud, and taking him down, wrapped him in the linen shroud, and laid him in the tomb that had been cut out of rock. And he rolled the stone against the entrance of his tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. When the Sabbath had passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe. And they were alarmed. He said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid.
Thank you, Carter and Selah, for reading this passage in Mark. I want to encourage you to read that again, maybe once we're done here tonight, or read that this week, maybe several times, just meditating on it, reflecting on it, what Jesus went through in his life for us. These events leading up to his death, his crucifixion, his resurrection. I love listening to the YouVersion Bible app and just listening to those words, this great narrative unfold before us. Jesus, he went through so much for us, even as last week as we were sharing, and how he endured that for us and did the will of his Father. And as I said last week, if are we ready for anything in God, even if it's not what we plan, even if it's not what we want? And Jesus did that for us. Will we do that for him? And it's okay. It's okay to be like, "Man, I got nothing left. I'm struggling right now with homework, with schoolwork, with being isolated from my friends, whatever it is, not being able to come to youth group, however you're feeling, that God will meet you there. His Spirit is there. And he wants to be present in your life to bring to refresh your soul, to give you strength when you're weak. And that's what he does for us. Now, I've been thinking about this passage and reading through this the last few days and the last week as I've been preparing for this message. And I kind of have a somber tone, I feel like, a little bit, because I just think of what Jesus went through for us. And even I'll just read a few verses. I won't read all of them since we just heard them. But think about this, verse 33, "And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour." Darkness. This was unusual. The middle of the day, darkness. Really, Jesus taking on the punishment that we deserve. There's this phrase called the day of the Lord that was talked about in the Old Testament. And there was pictures of that being a day of judgment and darkness. And it's not an accident that this is happening like this. It's because Jesus, he takes on the judgment that we deserve. It's a dark day for him and what he has doing for us. He even says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Which goes to a psalm. He's referring to Psalm 22. And yet he cries out. It's with the weight of the world's sin. He's crying out. And people are wondering, you know, is he calling out for Elijah? What's going on? Not understanding. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. from top to bottom. That the temple, this curtain, the holy of holies in this temple is where God's presence resided. And now it's being torn in two, really ending a moment in time where God's presence would reside in a temple. Now God's presence leaving the temple. And anyone who places their trust in Jesus are now temples of the Holy Spirit, temples of the Lord. We can experience his presence now because of this. So the temple torn in two. All of this is happening. There's darkness in the middle of the day. Jesus breathing his last, crying out and breathing his last, and the temple, the curtain torn in two. And who is witnessing this? I mean, there's a lot of people witnessing this, but one person in particular, Mark, witnesses this. Mark, he says who it is. The centurion, not a religious person, not a rabbi, not even one of Jesus' closest followers or disciples is saying this. The centurion, this Roman soldier, this person who participates in crucifying people, killing people, who stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last. He said, truly, this man was the Son of God. Really, this is the guy, the Son of God. Out of all the people that would say this, you wouldn't pick that, this person, if you were just making the story up. Sometimes people think, oh, you know, is this made up or whatever? It's like, look at who Jesus is in this story. You got this soldier, this Roman centurion, a non-Jewish, really pagan man who is responsible for killing people and crucifying people. He is the man that says, truly, this is the Son of God. And going on into the story, we get to see here, Jesus is buried. And in chapter 16, we see the three women, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, Salome. They're going there not to be like, oh, you know, it's Easter. Let's go see the empty tomb. He's risen. He's risen indeed. Let's go. Let's get over there. No, that's not what they're doing. We can see Mark says they brought spices so they might go and anoint him. The message says that they may go and embalm him. They're going there because he's dead, or at least that's what they think. You see, a Messiah, a king, an anointed one, a savior, a king. If a king is dead, then his kingdom is done. That's the way of this world. That's the way of the world back then. That's the way of the world now. You got a king, you kill the kingdom will fall. It is over. It is done. You're defeated. That kingdom has an end date, and that end date is when the king is killed. And this king is dead. And nobody's thinking, like, let's go, it's Easter Sunday, the tomb is empty, let's go and see. It's like Christmas morning even, right? Let's go, we're so excited. No, they're going to embalm his body. They don't want it to smell in the tomb with the spices, because more than likely they're going to put other bodies in there over the next year or so until they take Jesus's bones out of there and place it in another box where they place bones. So they were anticipating seeing a dead body in there. So they're going, and no wonder they're shocked. No wonder they're surprised, these women. And they see this man dressed in white and saying, hey, he's not here. They were saying to one another, who rolled away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb. And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. Verse 6, it says, and he, this is the man dressed in white, an angel or messenger of God of some kind. And he said to them, do not be alarmed. You see, Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, he has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell the disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. They were afraid. They were astonished. They were trembling. They weren't expecting to see this. They were in complete shock. I think sometimes we can just think, oh, you know, here we go. It's Good Friday and Easter again. We know the story. Those of you who've been a part of coming to Trinity or been a part of a local church for years or been a Christian for years, we can just kind of go through the motions and think, oh, yeah, this is going to happen. He's risen. He is risen indeed. Yay, it's Easter Sunday. But that first Easter, nobody was excited. Nobody was running to the tomb to see that it was empty when they first got there. No, these three women were shocked. They were trembling. They couldn't believe it because they went there to embalm his body, not to see an empty tomb. Who is God choosing to reveal this to? Who is the very first people? A Roman pagan, non-Jewish murderer, executioner, and women. You see, in the first century, women were not even, their witness wasn't even really valid for that time, for them to see an empty tomb, for them to be the first ones to actually tell people that the tomb was empty. Now, of course, in this narrative, we could see that they were afraid and they didn't tell anyone. That was their initial reaction. They couldn't. They were shocked. This truly, Jesus is the Son of God. They were experiencing that too. Wow. But they were trembling and astonished. Maybe for us this season, as I just think about this, as I just want that feeling, I want to remember what it was like to be astonished, to be shocked. This isn't supposed to happen. But because it has, we can see and say, and join with the centurion in saying, truly this man was the Son of God. Truly this man defeated death. When nobody else expected it, including myself. In the world's eyes, he was a failed Messiah because he died, a failed kingdom, a kingdom that did have an end date. But he defeated death. And because of that, we can say, truly, he is the Son of God. Now, I wanted to end with the end of verse 8 in chapter 16. Now, there is more verses after that that you can read on your own. I encourage you to read that. Now, some people kind of debate like, oh, you know, did Mark really mean to end here in verse 8? Maybe there was some other early manuscripts that were lost. And then, you know, later on, maybe a few decades later or something, some Christians, early Christians kind of added this part. You know, there's some debate on that. You can read this. You can read Matthew, you can read Luke and John, you can kind of see, well, yeah, a lot of those things happen there. So it's not like not biblical that it's in here. It just may or may not be what Mark originally wrote. Again, that's up for debate, and I just wanted to point that out because when I open up my student Study Bible, it makes a note about that. Some early manuscripts do not include in verses 9 through 20. I really believe that God allowed this to be in his word, and we trust, and his word is true and faithful. But what I love about this break here is that maybe we just pause verse 8 and just get back that astonished feeling to remember how unexpected this was. This was not supposed to happen. Even Jesus' closest followers and friends didn't expect this. These three women, three of his closest women followers here, were going there to embalm him. How amazing is this story? Jesus doing the unexpected and bringing hope when it looked like there was no hope. Bringing life where there was death. Bringing joy when there was sorrow and mourning of his death. That's what he does. God wants you to know that Jesus really is God's son. God wants you to know that Jesus really is the Son of God. Just think of who God chose to reveal this to. You might think, I'm not worth that, or I don't think that God is going to show that to me. Maybe you're watching this now and you're like, I don't really believe much of or any of this. God wants to show especially you that he is the Son of God, that Jesus is the Son of God. Even this Roman centurion, non-Jewish, non-religious person, this is the Son of God. Are these women, these three women, that really you wouldn't pick to be witnesses to the rest, the first people to see an empty tomb and to be witnesses of this first Resurrection Sunday? You wouldn't pick them, but yet God did. God is doing something unexpected and really upside down. And I want you to know that God wants you to know that. He wants you to know that Jesus is the Son of God. He died on the cross, taking on the judgment that we deserve, that I deserve. So it doesn't matter what you've done or not done, whether you're ready for anything in God or you're being just lazy through the pandemic and trying to sleep it away, or you're struggling with sin, or you're struggling with depression, or with anxiety, with stress, you feel like the weight of your world is crushing you, the weight of the world is just is putting pressure on you, you can barely breathe. Well, however you're feeling, that God wants you to know that Jesus is the Son of God. Because of that, that matters. That matters to your life. That matters to my life. That temple, the curtain ripping, ending one era, one time in the history of the people of God, and starting a new era, a new time, where anyone who places their trust in Jesus are now temples of the Holy Spirit, a place where God lives by the Spirit. Now, how I wish that we, and my prayer is really not wish, my prayer is that we could gather here next week. Now, I don't know if that's going to happen. It probably won't. So don't quote me on that. My prayer is that we could be in this youth room as soon as possible. But we don't need to be in here necessarily to experience the presence of God, to experience the Holy Spirit in our lives. If you're there by yourself, you can experience the Holy Spirit. If you're there with a few other people, whether it's your own family members who are followers of Jesus, or on Zoom or on FaceTime or Snapchat or Marco Polo or whatever app that you use, if you're there, you're encouraging one another, you're praying for each other, you're crying with one another, you're laughing with one another, that the Spirit of the living God is present because you're a follower of Jesus. And God wants you to know that Jesus is the Son of God. He defeated death. Because of that, you can have life now and forever because of what Jesus has done. He moves us from death to life, and we can see that because he lived that. He moved himself from death to life, defeating death. That's good news. That is good news for us all. My prayer for me, for sure, and definitely for you guys, is that we would just experience the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, that would refresh our souls when we need it most. That Jesus would be present with us, that God by his Spirit would be present with us, that God would show you that Jesus is the Son of God. And because of that, that changes everything. It changes everything for us. Even if we're stuck in our homes, it changes everything. What would it look like if we really saw that Jesus is the Son of God? How would that change our outlook when we get up in the middle of the, when we get up in the morning and we're like, I don't want to get out of bed. I don't want to do this. I don't want to be stuck in my room or stuck in my house or not being able to leave or not being able to see my friends. What would that look like if we really believed that Jesus was the Son of God? How would that help us to just get up in the morning? Because I know sometimes I need that. I need that. Maybe there's some of you who are watching who don't know Jesus, who have never seen that for yourself or believe that or placed your trust in Jesus, believing that he is the Son of God. Maybe this Easter or this season that we're in leading up to Easter would be the time that you would place your trust in him. You're not too far gone. You're not too far off that God can't reach out to you, grab you by the hand, and lead you to life, life now and forever. If you would place your trust in him, that you believe that, yeah, Jesus did die on the cross. I believe that, and that Jesus did take on the judgment for my sins. That's what this is all about. Darkness, middle of the day. Jesus taking on the sin of the world. And Jesus on the third day defeating death. No one expected it. It was a moment of awe. It was a moment of trembling. It was a moment of astonishment. It was a moment of just being in shock. It was spectacular, unlike anything that has ever happened before or after. If you place your trust in him, the Holy Spirit will be present and reside in you. You will be a temple of the Holy Spirit, a place where God lives. Jesus will be with you now and forever. That's my prayer, is that you would place your trust in him this season. And I'm going to be praying a lot about that for sure, for all of you, that even if we've placed our trust in Jesus, we can't lose sight of how important Easter is, how important Good Friday is, how important this is to our faith. Nobody expected it, and yet God did something amazing for us all. So thank you guys so much for watching this. I want to close in prayer, but please know that I'm praying for you. I know Aaron is, I know many of our leaders are. You guys are on our hearts. Please let us know if there's anything we can do to help you guys. I just wish I could see you all right now. Like I could look, I'm in the youth room, you guys know that. I could just wish I could see all your eyes, all your faces right now and just say, how much I love you guys. Can't wait to gather again with you soon. Don't hesitate, I'm serious, to reach out to us. We can't make it through this pandemic alone, okay? So I hope that you guys can gather with us online on Easter Sunday. It's gonna be a great Sunday on Good Friday as well. It's gonna be great. There's gonna be 2 service times on Good Friday and 2 on Sunday morning. So we'll get all that info out to you guys. But yeah, hope you guys can join us for that. Feel free to reach out to us, like I said. So let me pray. Father, I just want to take a moment to be silent. To remember that moment of Mary Magdalene, Mary, mother of James and Salome, how they were going on Easter Sunday, the first Easter Sunday, to embalm your son, Father. It was over. It was over. At least in a human perspective, it was over. And yet you did the unexpected. You really shocked these women. You shocked the centurion, this Roman soldier, executioner. Even before the resurrection, he was shocked with everything that was happening. This darkness, and this crucifixion, and all that was going on. Earthquakes and everything that was talked about in other gospels. And wow. May we not lose sight of the astonishment of the resurrection. The astonishment of your death. Thank you, Father. I pray for those that are watching this that maybe don't know you yet. Be with them. Show them your love. Show them that your son is the Son of God. That you came to save them from their sins and to give them everlasting, eternal life, life now and forever. Pray that they would reach out to someone. They could reach out to me or their friends that know you. If they have any questions about that, or if they want to place their trust in you, they can do that now or soon. Move in their hearts and their minds. Move in those who are listening or watching that have placed their trust in you. Just pray that you'd encourage their souls. If they're on fire for you, ready for anything in God, great. That's awesome. Fan the flame. Keep them moving. Keep them going. Keep them persevering. Be with them with their schoolwork, with all the things that they got going on. Be with them as they try and connect with their friends and family and neighbors and in ways that are safe. Be with those that are weary, that are weak, whether it's emotionally, spiritually, physically, mentally, whatever it is. They might feel like, oh, I can't go to God right now. I just feel awful. I can't. I got to feel better before I go to him. God, that is when they need to go to you the most. And that is when you want them to go to you the most. It's okay. Go to God. If you're feeling weary, if you're feeling weak, comfort us and encourage us. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So last week I had Adam come and kind of share briefly with you guys. He made me do something I shouldn't have. I shared a meme I shouldn't have shared. I need forgiveness. I apologize for that. But this week I asked Jason Gallagher to come and share and pray for you guys as well. We just want to continue to bring some of our leaders. We'll have some more leaders come and share in the next few weeks as long as we are doing this online thing. So, but thank you guys. I'll have Jason close things out for us. But
hey, what's up, guys? Hope you guys all survived your week of distance learning, homeschooling, or maybe you were even lucky enough to have the week off for spring break. Anyways, I miss you guys a ton. I miss the laughing, the games, the small group time, but I am so thankful that we get to actually still meet online to dig into God's Word together and to grow together. And I don't know about you guys, but this has been just absolutely a crazy time. I'm doing things differently than I've ever done them before in my entire life. And hey, I even got an Instagram account. I can't believe that happened. This is absolutely crazy. But anyways, I just want to encourage you guys because I know that right now it can seem like a lot of things have been taken away. Time with friends, maybe your job, sports, music, or other activities. But I want you to know that God has given us so much. And he's actually making room for us in this time. Time for us to grow with Him, to rest in Him, and to trust in Him completely. As hard as it is, take advantage of this time to develop new habits in your walk with God. Anyways, I can't wait to see you guys again. Miss you a ton, and hope to see you soon. All right, let's take a minute to pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for these students and this time that we had together tonight. I thank you for Mark, Aaron, and all the other leaders. Even in this time, you have provided so much, and you have provided us each other. You are an amazing God. And Lord, sometimes it can seem dark. It can seem like everything is against us. But it's not dark, not anymore. You rose from the grave and conquered death. Help us to remember your power, to trust in your power. Help us to live in the knowledge and comfort that you overcame all of it. And through that grace, we get to live in the light. So Lord, as we once again head back into our daily routines, I ask that you help us to also be that light to the people around us. Help us to connect with our friends and share your love with them. Help us to find new ways to serve people from a distance and be your hands and feet. Lord, we love you, we serve you, show us your purpose for us, and may we jump at the chance to fulfill it. In your name we pray. Amen. Have a great week, everybody.